Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. We've received apologies from Alistair Allen, MSP, and we welcome back to the committee Karen Adam, MSP, who will be attending as a committee substitute. Before we begin, can I remind everyone using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. We begin this morning with evidence session on the Sea Fisheries Remote Electronic Monitoring and Regulation of Scallop Fishing Scotland Regulation 2024 draft. We have approximately 90 minutes this morning, and I would like to welcome to the meeting Elspeth MacDonald, who's the Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, and Helen McLaughlin, who's the Head of Marine Policy from the RSPB Scotland, who's giving evidence on behalf of the Future Fisheries Alliance. And joining us remotely, we have Ian Gatt, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Pelagic Fishermen's Association, and Joe Whiteleg, the Fishery Control and Enforcement Manager from the Isle of Man Fisheries. So thank you very much for joining us this morning. I'll kick off with a straightforward question, and it's simply, do you believe that there is a need to introduce mandatory remote electronic monitoring, and is it clear what benefits REM, what the benefits are and how REM could improve fisheries management in Scotland? And we'll kick off with Elspeth.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning. I mean, this is a policy that the Scottish Government have been developing for a number of years now. There's been discussions with industry and with other stakeholders over a fairly protracted period. But I think we are still at a stage where the certainly the costs of mandatory REM are becoming clearer, but the benefits are perhaps less clear and less able to be articulated in terms of when they might be delivered and what they might cost to be delivered. So I think we probably can see some scope for benefits. There is scope for REM to develop a more sort of granular evidence base probably around where and how we fish, and that might be helpful in the context of marine spatial planning, for example. We know that there's increasing pressure for space for use in our seas, and that's something that we've spoken about a lot here and elsewhere. But I think we have to be realistic and honest that when it comes to having cameras aboard vessels, that is a matter that is about compliance. And I think that is the stick rather than the carrot. I think what's important is that we all understand that REM is a tool. It's not a solution in its own right. And what we really need are practical and achievable policies in place. And if you haven't got these in place before you put REM in, then you're rather putting the cart before the horse. So I think we can see the scope for some benefits from this. But we are concerned that, as I say, it is also very much about putting a compliance tool in place, whilst we're still very much in the scope of developing a new suite of fisheries management policies within Scotland. Thanks.
Just the Federation represents some scallop fishers. They currently, or some will currently, voluntarily have REM on their vessels. What was the reason for them voluntarily doing that, and have they seen any benefits, or what issues have they seen?
I think they could see that a mandatory approach was coming, and that was evident from the government's policy discussions over a number of years. So they could see that coming, and there was the possibility for the scallop fleet to have grant-funded assistance to put REM aboard, and I think a majority of them went down that road. I think they probably do feel that it, again, can help prove where they've been fishing and where they've not been fishing. But I think there have been some quite a number of technical issues with it. So I think there have been issues with its reliability and with them having a clear knowledge as to whether it is or isn't working on a particular day. And that's that's less of a problem when you've got something on a voluntary basis, but when it's required on a mandatory basis, then that is more significant. I think, again, I think they feel that the scope for benefits, the ability to deliver benefits, is not clearly articulated or not costed. So to deliver some of the benefits that I think that the government has set out might be possible with this, there's no way of saying how long that would take or how much it would cost to do that.
OK, thank you. Helen.
Thank you. I suppose I would perhaps maybe take a step back as to a little bit of the evolution of REM coming into being. I think when we had the introduction of the landing obligation with the 2013 Common Fisheries Policy, which basically obliged fishers to land what was caught, and that was in response to the concerns over the large amount of discarding that was going on across European waters, sort of 25% of what was being taken out of the water being discarded back in again. So the impetus was to try and improve selectivity, incentivise better management at sea. But of course, you put a regulation in which requires stopping an activity at sea, you need to be able to have eyes on whether or not that is being complied with. And I think since then, the European Enforcement Agency has very clearly said that there's been low compliance, and they have encouraged member states, coastal states, to introduce REM as the most robust and cost-effective means of monitoring that compliance. But I would also say it's not just about the targets docks that we're talking about, it's also about the impact that fishing is having on the wider marine environment. And across our seas, we have 15 indicators of ocean health, only 4 of them are green. So we're not doing a good job at the minute for our seas. And fisheries is recognised as one of the impacts on, is one of the biggest impacts on marine biodiversity. So making sure that we're doing the best job at how we fish, where we fish, the impact, minimising those, is clear. And remote electronic monitoring with cameras, sensors, will offer us that understanding that we are not only complying with what legislation there is, but also understanding better the impacts on our marine environment. So, for example, hundreds of thousands of marine mammals, seabirds, elasmobranchs, that's sharks, rays, skates, are caught incidentally each year in our waters. And we really have very little understanding of the true extent of that. So having cameras and vessels will allow us to improve that. Supply chain, confidence, greater trust in the management system, all of these things will be improved by having that, the suite of data that is there that we're able to. So we've had certainly had cases where fishermen have said, well, you know, but we think something is going on here, and then being able to evidence it with cameras. So it's about co-management, but improving that trust and transparency in the supply chain and giving greater confidence to consumers that when they buy Scottish fish, there is a high degree of confidence of sustainability. So we see those as very much the benefits. And it's not something that we're doing just here. It's something, I mean, REM is a tried and tested management tool being used mandatorily in a number of countries across the world to very good effect.
Thank you. We're now going to move to Joe Whyleg. Welcome, Joe, from the Isle of Man. The Isle of Man is something I can see most mornings because the sun always shines in Dumfries and Galloway, and I can look across the sea to the Isle of Man. So I feel like you're a very close neighbour to me down in Kirkcudbright. So can I ask you for your perspective on how REM is working in the Isle of Man?
We haven't actually got REM fitted on any of our vessels yet. We're wholly supportive of the Scottish Government's approach to REM. Obviously, the Isle of Man's been heavily involved in working groups towards putting REM on the vessels and creating the SI. We're not far behind you, to be honest. We've got, obviously, we have a number of vessels that go on fish in Scotland for the summer, so they will need REM. We're consulting at the moment with suppliers for REM, and we're fully behind it. We think it's a good... It's another part of an enforcement tool. It's like part of the arsenal for the enforcement tool.
So, just to clarify, this is maybe a misunderstanding. This is your understanding that Manx vessels will require REM to fish in Scottish waters?
Yes, from June, and we are actively working to make that happen.
Okay, that's grand. Thank you. We're now going to join Ian Gatt, who I think is also out of the country, slightly further away than Isle of Man. Ian, welcome.
Yes, good morning, convener from Barcelona. I'm here attending the Seafood Expo Global, and something I would recommend to the committee to do at some point to give you a wider perspective of what's going on in the world. It's absolutely staggering. So I'm here helping our pelagic processors with in engagement. In terms of the REM, I think Elspeth rightly said, look, this has been a policy. It's been developed over many, many years. But, you know, from our perspective, I just think it's probably another unnecessary layer of control when we have a really good control system in place. The compliance officers know where each vessel is at any time. They can see whether they're steaming, they're hauling. And then when the vessels land, of course, that all the landings are inspected. So I just think it's an additional cost. It's going to be an additional cost to the fleet. We don't see the benefits in it. But I also think it's a huge cost going to be to government when, you know, the marine budget is extremely tight as it is, and something's got to give. In terms of this, and we can see that, you know, for instance, issues around the production of science, you know, all being sacrificed in terms of the what's going on with the budgetary cuts, and yet this has been a government choice to add in the additional layer of control, and you ask the question yourself, well, you know, what is the issue? What is the issue? Is there no confidence in terms of the pelagic fleet? Are the stocks in a bad shape? And we know that they're not. You know, all of the stocks are at or above the scientific recommended levels. So it does beg a question of why so much effort and money has been put towards this particular policy when it's not a big issue. In terms of the control, so I have to say, you know, the government are selling this as being a great thing for the scientific benefits. We employ a scientist, and we can't see for ourselves what the additional information they're going to achieve through the policy. And also, it's so, and Helen mentioned it, oh, the market's asking for it. I'm dealing with the market on a daily basis with the Scottish processors, retailers, domestically and externally. And we'll probably have meetings with them every fortnight, different retailers, people in supply chain. Never once has any of them come to me and said, oh, we would really like you to have REM. What their concern is in terms of the pelagic industry is, look, can we get quota sharing agreements across coastal states in the Northeast Atlantic? That's their concern, not REM.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kenny.
And I move to a question from Emma Harper.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to you, and thanks for being here this morning. I just have a couple of quick questions about the technical specifications about the remote electronic monitoring systems. Some of the stakeholders responded to the committee's call for evidence, saying there was a lack of clarity around the technical specifications. So I would be interested to hear from you if you're clear about what equipment is required, and is there enough information about the tech specifications for the electronic monitoring systems? I'm looking at Elspeth, because you're nodding.
Not insofar as I can see. You know, the face of the SSI and the BRIA that supports the SSI talk about the different aspects, the different bits of technology that will be required for an REM system. So the positioning system, the wind sensors and the cameras, but doesn't go into any technical detail as to what that looks like. And the SSI talks about the ministers having the me wishing to change the technical specification from time to time, but it's very vague. So it's not clear how frequently they might wish to change the technical specification, and it doesn't appear, certainly from what I have seen, that there's any scope for there to be sort of scrutiny of that technical specification or any obligation to consult upon what it might be. So I think the fact that the technical specification is not there's no clear linkage with from the SSI in terms of how often that might change, how industry, who are, let's face it, the people who are going to be required to put it in place, to pay for it, to make it work, and to have their activities monitored through it, don't have any opportunity to have a say on that, unless there are going to be informal policy discussions around it, but there's certainly there doesn't appear to be any legal obligation for there to be consultation on that or for there to be scrutiny of that for yourselves or indeed for ourselves. I think, too, there's issues around that we have to think about, and Joe mentioned a moment ago that they're looking at putting REM in place in the Isle of Man fleet, and Helen alluded to things that might happen in the EU. I mean, if this is a policy that becomes more widespread, I think there are issues around how businesses need to work within perhaps specifications that diverge if they're not the same, and how do you deal with obsolescence? And I think there's a number of really quite sort of detailed technical issues that I think need a lot further consideration.
Just to come back a wee bit on that, and I'm not sure if the others want to come in as well. You're saying the ministers can change technical specifications. Would that be because the technology might evolve to be improved, for instance, improved cameras? I mean, what we are learning or what we can learn from Canada, New Zealand, USA, that have REM technology already, so that would allow technological specifications to be changed, basically?
Yes, I mean, the SSI says ministers may change it from time to time, but doesn't set the criteria under which what these changes might be required for. So it could be improved technology, it could be because the current specification doesn't work very well. It's giving them very open-ended grounds of which to change the technological specifications, as far as I can see.
Okay. Thanks.
Rachel, to ask a supplementary on your response, Elspeth, then I'm going to bring in Joe.
Well, it's actually something that Ian Gatt had said in his consultation submission, which was the fact that the pelagic boats already had cameras installed. So I was wondering how the people that had already got those cameras installed, how they would meet the guidelines that the government are setting. Is it a like for like? Ian?
Yeah, I think that's it's a very good question there, Rachel, and I think it's unclear at the moment. As I put in my written submission, there are a lot of cameras in pelagic vessels in all the critical areas, probably where the government would like to see covered. But I think in the specification it talks about frame speeds, etc. And I'm unclear at this moment in time whether the cameras that are there would fit the specification. So the short answer to that is we don't know. The other thing, I think, in terms of the specification is, first of all, I agree with Elspeth. I think it's disappointing there's no, for instance, the committee can't scrutinise the technical specification. That's going to be left to the government. And who knows where it'll go over time. But one of the key things that we don't know at this moment in time is how many suppliers there are going to be out there who are able to provide the equipment that we don't have already, which is the winch sensors, the black box, etc. And how many engineers will there be available to actually install and then maintain the systems? Because one of the key criteria, it says in there, which is extremely concerning for us, is that after a second trip and there's a malfunction in the equipment, then the vessel's got to stop fishing. And as you all know, the pelagic seasons can be very, very short, just a matter of weeks. And, you know, I'm really concerned that a vessel could be tied up in port, unable to get his system functioning again, and the fishing season goes past him and he's not able to, you know, fulfil his quota. So these are genuine concerns that, you know, we've no knowledge in how this will be handled. And, you know, an alternate solution could be, instead of saying, right, the vessel's got to tie up after the second trip, could be, look, we need to report more frequently. But I think it would be a really sad situation if you've got a vessel who can't catch his quota because he can't get his equipment functioning. And Elspeth's already said it in terms of the scallop industry have encountered problems with our equipment. So I think for the committee, I think this would need further scrutiny.
Ask you talked about the maximum frame rates that the cameras could capture. And I know that the tech spec suggests that it's a minimum of 2 megapixels per frame, a minimum horizontal resolution of 1920 pixels per frame, has infrared capability, has a minimum IP rating of IP66. There are specifications there. I suppose my question is, are you confident that those specifications are sufficient to comply with the legal and policy aims of the government? And also, the REM that's currently on scallop boats, do they comply just now, or are we looking at whole-scale a whole new REM system being installed on the scallop fleet?
I couldn't answer in the scallop fleet one, convener, and my short answer to you is I don't know. I don't know if the cameras currently on board the pelagic vessels will comply with the requirements. I sincerely hope they do, because there are a lot, as I said, there's a lot of cameras already on board, and, you know, at least if we could use the ones that are there, it would fulfil the policy objectives, then, you know, that would be a huge help.
But can maybe touch on the scallops.
Yeah, it's not my understanding that that the scallop vessels that already have REM are going to have to change that system. But, and I think that will be reflected in the coming into force date for the scallops, which is clearly much sooner than for the pelagic vessels because they don't have it. So that's not my understanding. But as I said a moment ago, and as Ian repeated, I think one of the concerns that the scallop fleet have is when the technology fails, as it sometimes has, and I think, and this is not an uncommon issue, you are completely at the mercy of somebody coming to fix it. Now, I do believe that the intention with winch sensors is that these will be vessels will be able to use a sort of simplified winch sensor that they should be able to fix themselves. But with the other equipment, you're going to be reliant on technicians, engineers being available and able to come and fix it. And as Ian said, when you've got a ticking clock, if you like, in terms of your fishing season, and you're at the mercy of other parties to come and fix your equipment, that causes some real concerns for the industry.
Okay, thank you. I'm aware that Rachel and I both interrupted Emma's question, so I'm going to move to Joe to ask whether you have whether the Isle of Man Marine compliance have any issues with the technical specification. Have you had any means or any reason to suggest the technical spec could give rise to issues?
It's one of the points that I've been asked to highlight, actually, is obviously the fact that it's still quite vague what the actual specifications were, and there's obviously the changes can be made to make sure you can back up the changes in effect. So we have the same concerns as the party spoke before.
Okay, thank you. Helen.
Well, I probably don't have a lot to add to that, other than that, you know, in terms of, I know from experiences around where REM has been applied in other countries around the world, good governance is about making sure that you get the specification right. So I think the flexibility that was allowed by having the requirement not to constantly come back to make possibly minor adjustments is something that actually is quite good, because you might, you know, you might want to deal with the application differently depending on your management objectives. So but obviously that's something for officials at you.
Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, convener. Morning, panel. In some ways, Ian and Elspeth have already answered the questions I was going to put about the reliability of the systems and repairs. I mean, we heard from the committee's call for views, the industry stakeholders' views about the availability of marine electronic companies and engineers. I wonder if you could give me your response about or your thoughts about the 28-day grace period for the scallop vessels, and also the thoughts on how that impacts on the rural and island areas where most of these vessels are fishing from.
Yeah, I think if I read the SSI correctly, then the 28-day period only seems to apply in relation to the wind sensor element of the system. And of course, there's the three elements. There's the cameras and the positioning system. So I think I mentioned a moment ago, it's our understanding that there's going to be a provision whereby the wind sensor that can be used can be something that can be fixed by the vessel themselves, and perhaps is less dependent on requiring an engineer to come and do it. So I think if that is the case, then that clearly would be something that is less reliant on a third party having to come and do it, assuming, of course, you have access to the piece of kit that you require. But I think in terms of the other elements of the system, again, it's as Ian described, there are some pretty stringent rules around what happens after the first breakdown and what happens then after the second breakdown. I mean, clearly the scallop fleet is less constrained by the very tight seasonal fishery that the pelagics have, but nonetheless, these are businesses that have, and I think, as again the BREEA, the Business Regulatory Impact Assessment, sets out, the profitability of the scallop fleet is pretty low, and any time lost while you are unable to fish because you are awaiting repairs is going to cut into that already pretty small profitability, and has got, I think, the scope to really affect the viability of some of the vessels.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Would you like to come in on the same point?
It's not a thing I have studied, convener, because it's largely applicable to the scallop sector. Maybe Jill.
Okay, can I just ask a supplementary on it? Do you believe some of the mitigating solutions, so for example, we had suggestions that a vessel could be required to maintain a minimum speed, which would reflect the fact that it wasn't fishing, required to stay a certain distance from closed fishing areas or whatever. Do we need to see that on the face of the SSI for it to be fit for purpose to deal with the issue with potential downtime?
It's hard to say at this point, isn't it, without much sort of practical experience of how it's working. You know, I think what this does require, I think what the experience thus far has shown us is that those vessels who've had these systems in place voluntarily, have had issues with it, have had issues of reliability and of things breaking down, and they've had to deal with that. But they've been able to deal with that in a way that hasn't had this same full force of the law sitting over and above its use. So I think what this really needs is a hefty dose of pragmatism and practical solution finding and problem solving between government and industry. I don't know how possible it would be to list every sort of possible mitigation that you might put in place to help somebody to continue to fish while a system was being repaired if there was factors beyond their control. I don't know that you could necessarily list all those mitigations on the face of an SSI, but I think what there needs to be is an absolute willingness to be pragmatic and practical about finding ways.
Does this allow you to do that, though? Does the instrument that we're going to have to make a decision on allow that pragmatism?
Well, I think it may do, because it talks about the ministers being able to give, conditions can be set. So it doesn't specify what they are, but it does seem to signify that officials will have some capacity to be able to apply a degree of pragmatism.
Okay, thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Just a wee supplementary on that. Given that some of your members have already fitted this and they're working with it, how often do they become faulty and how long does it take to fix them? Have you picked up any?
I couldn't really answer how often do they become faulty, but I have heard of examples where they've taken weeks to be fixed, not days or hours. So, these might be outliers. I don't have a comprehensive list of issues, but certainly issues have been raised with me where people have been waiting for weeks to have their gear repaired, to have technicians able to come and fix the kit.
Would it be helpful then if government were much more specific and said this is the system you use, so that technicians could be available at ports, or indeed replacement parts could be available at ports if you're sending something away to be fixed that you can then slot something else in? It just seems to me that if everyone's doing this, is there the opportunity for either government or a co-op or yourselves as an association to kind of say to your members, well, if we all get this, then we can have the technicians guaranteed of the work and we can have parts there. Is there a solution?
Possibly, but I guess there's just the issues too of how the market works and how whether government feels it's appropriate to be absolutely sort of dictating. You can only have one system. I think what they're trying to create is, vessels can choose the system that they wish, as long as it is compliant with the requirements. But yes, that does bring, I guess it does bring issues of, you've got different systems and different companies might provide one and not another. So I guess it is a question of, what the market will do. I see logic in what you're suggesting. I don't know just how much, how easy it would be to sort of get everybody to agree on one sort of system. Because as Ian said, if you think about his fleet, the pelagic fleet, there's a huge amount of technology already on these vessels, and they may want to buy particular kit that will fit in more easily with their technology than others, for example. So, yeah, we will have to sort of see what how the market sort of shakes out, I suppose.
Thank you. Thanks.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Under this instrument, Scottish ministers will be able to serve a data transmission request notice. So I'd like to ask, what is your understanding of that, what it means, and any other thoughts that you have on this? If I can come to Ian first, please.
Yeah, it's a very interesting one, Karen. We know that if there is a request coming that we need to supply the data within 5 days. And it's one that we would like probably for the committee to inquire with the minister when she comes before you. What actually is the circumstances that triggers the request for the REM data? Because I don't think it's very clear, neither in the SSI or in the technical specification, what that requirements would be. So it's certainly something I think that the committee should be trying to dig into in terms of that.
That's helpful. Thanks. Ian, Elspeth?
Yeah, I agree. Don't have anything to add to that. I think it would be helpful to understand that better. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Rachel and then Ariane.
It was a supplementary to Karen's question there on the data transmission request notice. It appears that a number of Scottish vessels have already been giving data to Marine Scotland. And I just wondered, you know, how is that data being used? Do you see that data? Is the science for compliance or is the science for opportunity for fishermen to, for example, ensure that they have the right quotas? I'm unsure as to what this data does and whether there will be the resource to ensure that that data that has been requested is effectively used. Can I come to Elspeth first?
Mm-hmm. I think that gets to the crux of a lot of this, Rachel, and I think it is about, you know, what benefits might flow from this. There's much that has been set out in the policy discussion around, you know, how we've got to where we are today, and again set out in the BRIA about the potential benefits, but they are, in terms of science, in terms of improved science, they are potential. You know, I am not aware of any beneficial scientific impacts that the data that has already been requested from the part of the fleet that already has it has generated. I think probably what it has been able to do is provide assurance to the government, to the compliance team around gear, where vessels are fishing, what they've been doing, what gear they've been using. But I am not aware that it has provided any scientific benefit or anything yet that the industry would see as a beneficial purpose. And I think that's perhaps one of the frustrations that some of the vessels that already have experienced, that they feel that it is all stick and not carrot.
Okay. Would anyone else like to come in on that point? Ian? And then Helen.
Yeah, it's really interesting in terms of the scientific benefits. And the thing that we see in the system in terms of providing, say, some information is actually just verifying information we're already given. So to give you a bit of a flavour for it, and as I said to you, that we employ a scientist in the association. We run this program actually in conjunction with the government called a self-sampling and co-sampling project in terms of data. And what does that mean? It means that every vessel, every pelagic vessel, takes samples of the catch of every haul. So we're already providing that information. And what the REM is, they're requesting us to do, is to put a camera above the person who is actually measuring the fish and providing that information. So I don't see it's providing anything additional that we're doing already. We're already providing length and weight information of each and every haul currently. So I don't see it's adding anything, Rachel, at this stage. Whether it develops into something, I don't know, but there's nothing new or innovative there.
Okay, Helen.
I suppose I would say with REM, you're collecting an enormous amount of data. You're not always reviewing that enormous amount of data, but it's there. If you were, you can go back and scrutinise it for different policy objectives or scientific objectives. So, for example, if you wanted to look at, you know, what is the mix of any haul, for example. Now, in a pelagic fishery, Ian will tell you much better than I about how high those percentages are of that's your target, that's the percentage. But there may be other species in there, and This will give us an understanding of maybe when that occurs. It could also look at, you know, we need to have confidence in the levels of potential slippage or discarding in any operation across our fleets. And as I said previously, we really have very little understanding of the impact of a lot of our vessels on non-target species such as seabirds, marine mammals, etc. So building that sort of evidence bank of, you know, positive or negative, if we can demonstrate that this is not a problem, then that's great, and there is the evidence. But that's what the cameras within the system allow you to do. Your GPS system gives you location, the winch will give you indication of when the fishing activity is occurring, and the cameras will then look at what's coming up in the hull and the mix of that. So I think it's really that additional evidence.
Helen, is it really science for compliance then? So it's a bit like you said, you need confidence in the sector. Is it because you don't trust the sector and you want to see what they're doing, a bit like Big Brother? Or is it because, as you started off in your introduction, you want to see the data that is given to actually improve some of the targets that you say in the marine environment are not being achieved? But how do you do that, and does Marine Scotland have the resource to do that? Because is it science for compliance, or is it science for opportunity?
So I think it's a bit of both. I think we need to have confidence across the board in our fishing fleet and the impacts that they're having, not just on the target species, but also in the non-target species. And yes, as you say, Scotland could be potential leader, talk about sustainable fisheries, and this evidence is that. It's able to say, look, we can demonstrate we're fishing in a sustainable manner, our impacts on the stock are X, and our impacts on non-target species are Y. But that latter one of the non-target impacts is really something we have very, very little data about, and this will give us a much better understanding across fleets about exactly what those impacts are. And really important, and at a relatively low cost in comparison to...
I just wonder if you can... sorry to push this, but if you can cite some of the current studies that have been done to identify that non-target species have been taken from the waters through this, the current studies that have been done on Scottish vessels.
So at the minute, it's about less than 3% of fishing activity has been monitored at sea for non-target bycatch, and it's a difficult thing to do because it's mostly undertaken by observers. So human observers going on vessels, that's a very timely, costly, they're a scarce resource. Having cameras on vessels will allow you to have 100% eyes on what's happening at sea, and will be, you know, you can scrutinise for sensitive species bycatch, for example. It's mostly at the time of hauling where you would you would be able to see whether something else is coming up in the haul, whether that's something getting caught in the warps or getting caught in the catch itself. And the camera footage allows you, in conjunction with the winch footage, because the winches would indicate, right, it's being hauled in.
But those vessels have had REM.
But they haven't for purposes of looking at the non-target species to allow any scrutiny of it for purposes of impact.
What was the point in? It's not your fault, but what is the point of having the trials if this is setting the precedent to deliver REM across the fleets, when this is what RSPB want, is to look at that outcome, when the trials have not even proven that that can happen without citizen science on board? It just doesn't make sense.
Which trials are you referring to?
Well, I mean, Elspeth was indicating that there have been trials that have happened with REM in place to then work out whether the outcomes that the government want from this will then actually be achieved. And what is the point in doing a trial when we can't prove that those outcomes will actually be met? I don't get it myself, but that's maybe my personal opinion.
Well, I can only go on what has happened elsewhere across the world and where cameras have been used very effectively in fishing operations to provide that greater understanding of the impact of the fishing activity on non-target species, as well as target species, because let's not forget that we actually do start to get a richer understanding of that. But for non-target species particularly, having cameras there to provide the data, the evidence of what the impact is has been vital and has allowed then to have mitigation in some cases, where there are mitigation options, where we can actually start to prevent that. And when you start looking at the endangered nature of some of the species that we're talking about, these sorts of measures are vital to try and get mitigation out on vessels, as well as accompanying it with cameras to make sure that's working.
We will be moving on to sustainability and science questions that might tease tease that out a little bit more. Before we move on, Joe indicated he wanted to come in, and then Elspeth and Ariane. Excuse me. Sorry, Joe.
Yeah, so I'm not looking at this as obviously the enforcement officer. I'm looking at this from an enforcement perspective. And we have had an example where we have used our REM under a data protection request with the assistance of Marine Scotland to have a successful prosecution in the Isle of Man. And obviously the Isle of Man has very strict curfews and very strict information on gear. And using the REM footage as additional evidence, there was other evidence as well that would have probably been enough to enable a prosecution. But we could specifically demonstrate using the cameras when he used his winches, when he hauled his gear, the fact he had too much gear on board the boat, the fact that he had too many teeth bars on his actual dredges himself, and using that evidence, which was crystal clear evidence, we put that into our package and, like I said, enabled successful prosecution. So that is why the Isle of Man government is so supportive of REM from an enforcement perspective.
Thank you. Elspeth.
Yeah, I think that's a good example of how it's easy in this discussion, I think, to get quite... to sort of get quite muddled around the separation between compliance and what are being described as other potential benefits. And I think what Joe has just set out there is clearly
compliant, yeah.
REM being used as part of a compliance operation and, as I say, stick rather than carrot. The carrots that are being sort of dangled around this policy are about scope for better science, scope for more data for marine spatial planning, etc. But I think, looking at science for a minute, I think we must not underestimate how much resource it would take to use the data from REM to develop better science around fisheries and marine environment. This is touched on in the BRIA that supports the SSI, and I think I was surprised at how little the government seems to think it's going to cost to perhaps deliver some of what they've talked about as scientific benefits. It looks like a very small amount of money. And I think, as Ian said in his opening remarks, you know, we're in a time when resources are very tight. We have some real concerns about the ability of Marine Directorate to deliver its current scientific obligations. And I have... a lot of reservations about how they could really turn the data from REM into meaningful, useful science without having to invest a very large amount of money.
We will be moving on to that. It's very difficult to not to stray into the other topics, but we're going to stick to this just now. Ariane, you had a supplementary on requesting REM data.
I do, and I may stray there as well. So that's really interesting to hear your concerns, Elspeth, around the Marine Directorate and the ability to have the capacity to robustly monitor the data. I'd be interested to hear thoughts on yours and Helen's, possibly, around the idea of the data that's generated from REM systems being shared. So, for example, Peru in 2018 became the second country in the world
to share all of their VMS
data. We're actually coming on to that later. That's a specific question that will be asked. We're just looking at the data transmission. There is, before we move on to the next question, there is one specific question. It may be more for the Cabinet Secretary, but Elspeth, can you tell us why you believe there's no equivalent power to serve a data transmission request to a scallop vessel, but there is on a pelagic vessel? Is that more a question from the Cabinet Secretary?
Yes, yes, I think that would be a question for her.
Okay. We're going to move on to the topic of offences and penalties. A question from Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Just looking at the Scottish Government's website and also looking at the information in front of me, the instrument specifies that offences for breach of the regulations in the Sea Fish Conservation Act, there's penalties that are set out, and part of it talks about a fine up to or not exceeding £50,000, or there's other things listed regarding the court that can impose additional fines but not exceeding the value of the fish caught in contravention of the Act. The Scottish Government's website, it talks about Marine Scotland compliance is responsible for the monitoring and enforcement of marine and fishing laws. And again, it talks about the result can be a fine of up to £50,000. So I'd be interested to hear if you think that this maximum penalty is appropriate and proportionate. I'll come to Elspeth first.
Well, I think the penalties set out are in line with this broader suite of penalties available in this area. So I think it seems reasonable that they're consistent with the other penalties for non-compliance of fishing legislation. They don't appear to differ from those that are existing in relation to other technical legal requirements on the industry.
Okay, and as you're saying, it's equivalent to other pieces of legislation, but the up to £50,000 would be part of a range of penalties,
yes,
for non-compliance.
Absolutely, and that obviously is a decision that any court would make. Should a conviction be taken to its should a legal case result in a prosecution result in a conviction being made, then it would be for the court to decide where on that spectrum the penalty should sit.
Okay.
Okay. Like to come in on that? No.
Oh.
Yeah, Kate.
Thanks very much. In terms of the weight of pressure, I suppose, on fishers right now, in terms of regulation and so on, and the risk of the conviction here, would you say that fishermen are already it's a significant cost already in terms of meeting the regulation that currently exist. And clearly we want to ensure that fishermen are doing the right thing. But what could a fine like that do to a business?
Yes, and that's a good question. I think, again, when you look at the profitability in the scallop sector, for example, you know, the profitability in that sector, as the BREEA sets out, has been falling in recent years. Scallop vessels range in size from small vessels that will perhaps only fish scallops part-time to bigger ones that will be all that they fish. But you can see that where you've got vessels with relatively low profitability, maybe only £30,000 a year, then a significant fine could really eat into the profitability of that vessel and perhaps threaten its viability. So I think that's why it's really important that courts are very careful in thinking about how they apply penalties in the result of a conviction. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. We're going to move on to our next theme on sustainability and science. A question from Rhoda Grant.
Yeah. A lot of this has been covered earlier, but if I can just kind of push people back a wee bit to... There was discussion about how this was the carrot rather than the stick with REM, and I wonder if the Scottish Government has been clear to the industry as to how this carrot is going to work. How are they going to use this information for scientific research? How are they going to use it for to provide more sustainability in supply chains? Have they kind of demonstrated those positive impacts to you, Elspeth?
From my perspective, no. They've been, they are spoken about very much as could, may, in future. So it's it's what you might describe as sort of jam tomorrow. You know, there's possibilities here, but we haven't got any way yet of describing how we could do that or anything concrete in terms of setting out a sort of pathway to how you could get some of those more positive benefits. And as I say, I have... significant reservations about the resources that would be needed to achieve that.
Okay. Helen, you talked about this providing those benefits elsewhere. I don't know if you could kind of explain how that works in other countries where the system's in place and what benefits come from it and in what way.
Yeah, so as I said, originally, a lot of the impetus for looking at REM was to address the issue of discarding and incentivising more selective fishing, which would result in less discarding. And that's really about what we're taking out of our seas, because that's sometimes quite different to what we actually land in terms of fisheries. And that the idea about improving selectivity was to absolutely focus down on minimising the stuff that's extra to the target, so being as selective as possible and just removing the fish that you're really trying to do and not touching on non-target species. So that's definitely been clearly and successfully addressed in places like the US, where discarding levels were significantly high in the Western groundfish fishery, and basically the fishery was stopped as a result of the high levels of discarding, and the industry was given the opportunity to come up with a solution. And the solution was either you go with REM and you build that system into your working operating practice, or you look at, you know, an alternative that would be to take on board observers. As I said previously, they're expensive, they're, you know, they need training, they're not always available, etc., etc. REM was a much lower cost and fulfilled a lot more functions. They were then able to start operating again using REM, and that's been very successful, and that fishery has gone on, stock levels have increased as a result, etc. In New Zealand, for example, one of the...
Yep. Because that is interesting, but that's kind of almost the policing part of it. Mm. I'm just wondering how the science that was gathered from REM was used to create the situation where gear was more selective, where, because the fishery was closed unless they took a REM. So that seems a wee bit like the stick. I'm just wondering how, other than not fishing as much, how that information was used to make the fishing more selective rather than saying don't dare catch anything that you shouldn't be catching.
Sure. So obviously the problem there was stock levels decreasing, and so the science was obviously indicating there's a problem here, and we need to do something about it. So monitoring with cameras allowed that ongoing evidencing of what was being removed from the water, and not in the most selective way possible, and helping to use more selective methods. So, you know, fisheries can use a range of gear types and can choose to fish in ways and in areas that they know where they will stand a better chance of minimising or increasing, rather, their selectivity. So
the cameras really help to incentivise that so that you then start to get... And it's all absolutely reliant on good governance and feedback and communication between the administrations, the scientists and the fleet, because everybody's interest is in the sustainability of the resource that's being fished, but equally on the sustainability of the wider marine environmental impacts. So marine protected areas, for example, that's been a really important part of the you know, how do we protect marine protected areas? How do we evidence fishing in and out of those areas? And we've seen places like the Devon and Severn Ithaca, for example, in England, using REM and really lauding that as a very successful way with which they can protect their marine protected areas, because as a vessel goes in, the GPS indicates they're entering it, which they're absolutely at will to do. But if they start fishing, the winch sensor is indicated and compliant, so then able to be aware of that. So it helps with our wider marine protections in protecting those areas that we know are important for the health of our waters.
Does it give feedback? So if someone was fishing somewhere where they wouldn't normally fish, and we see that happening when a fishery is closed and you get people moving out of their normal fishery into a different fishery just because they have to make a living. Does it work both ways? Does it warn people that you're coming into a marine protected area, or warn of any kind of criteria they need to meet in different areas? Does it work both ways? Does it give the fisher folk better ideas of what they should be doing and where?
My understanding is that it does, but Joe will probably be able to give you more details. But I know from that IFCA trial, it will alert the skipper as well as compliance about when you enter into an area, because the coordinates will be clear. And that will be alerted to that, so then you can shift. But, Joe's maybe better able to answer that in more detail.
OK, Joe, are you able to answer that?
I'm not sure, to be honest. All I know is that, because obviously with our discussions with the providers of REM, And obviously looking at the data side of it, because we're looking at it, if a vessel fishes in Scotland and they've got REM and it comes down to Isle of Man waters, then we need to have access to the data. This is across the borders. We've been told that by the providers. Now, whether they could set a geofence up, which is an effective border for a closed area, to show when a vessel goes in and out of that, I'm not sure. But obviously there's already systems in place for that. There's the VMS system that can have fences set around it, and obviously the fishermen should be aware of the regulations of where they're fishing before they go in those closed areas anyway. So,
okay. Just a simple question to Elspeth and Ian. Has the government been clear on how REM will benefit the likes of seafood supply chains?
No, not as far as I'm concerned. It's all very vague and general. There might be benefits, but no, nothing clear, nothing concrete, nothing tangible, as far as I'm concerned.
Ian?
Yeah, I'm on mute now, yeah. Thank you. I just back up what Elspeth said. It's all very woolly about the Marine Directorate having discussions with the supply chain and saying that this is all wonderful and, you know, it'll be great for the market in the Scottish seafood. As I've already said, that I'm in contact very closely with the market on a regular basis, this week in particular, and nobody has said to me on any occasion that this is a policy area they would really like to be taken forward and taken forward quickly. The focus, certainly from a pelagic perspective, has been, look, we need to get quota sharing agreements in place across the Northeast Atlantic for the key species, mackerel, herring and blue whiting. That is their focus. It has never been an REM.
Thank you. I'll move on to a question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I think this is a very interesting conversation. I just want to remind myself that also, you know, I think this SSI and this REM work sits within the Fisheries Act of 2020, the UK Fisheries Act, which is calling on us to work with an ecosystems-based approach, and also the Marine Scotland Act of 2010. Again, in both cases, what we're trying to do is ensure the long-term success of our fisheries. So we say that REM helps us to understand that full picture of the state of our fisheries, and then therefore how to act appropriately as and when is needed in case we're on the edge of a fisheries collapse. But you had, I think we've been talking about the data. I'm going to come back to data. So both the fishing industry and NGOs have pointed out that REM data could be useful for marine spatial planning and to mitigate the spatial squeeze. And I remember that tremendous evening event that SFF held in the garden lobby a while ago, raising that issue. I'd like to get your views on how you think REM data could be useful in these ways in terms of marine spatial planning and mitigating against that spatial squeeze. We know there's going to be the expansion of renewables, for example, but also for conservation objectives. So I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on that, Elspeth, and then maybe Helen.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the challenges that we often have in discussions about marine spatial planning and in terms of our discussions with government are, you know, having sufficiently granular data that you can demonstrate the impact that, say, exclusion of fishing from an area would have on the industry. So REM may generate some benefits in that regard in terms of having more positional data than is generated through VMS. And of course, we know also that the government has consulted upon and we believe still intends to make it a requirement for vessels fishing inshore also to have tracking and monitoring, and that will one of the benefits of that certainly would be a means to give us much better information in relation to fishing within inshore areas, and that could be very useful for things like identifying cable routes, etc. But as I say, that I think is of the sort of several benefits that have been floated around REM in the consultation, in the BRIA, in all the discussions that we've had to now. I think that's probably the one that is most likely to be realised. But I think we have to be very clear about this. Doesn't mean that the data is a free for all. You know, data is data from these sorts of systems will be there will be a lot of issues around commercial confidentiality of data when we look at when we are discussing with government and with others around, for example, developments offshore. You know, we have to be exceptionally careful about how data is used, how it is anonymised. There are issues also around the privacy of individuals. So I think we have to be very, very careful and very, very thoughtful indeed in terms of understanding the constraints on data that REM systems will generate. And I think we also have to point to what are the objectives of the policy. And the BRIA talks clearly about the objectives being compliance, deterring non-compliance, and accountability to ministers. And for me, that makes it very clear that the data that is generated by these systems should be retained within government and is not data that can be made freely available to others.
Thanks. Helen?
Yeah, I mean, I think the way that we use our seas is really of vital interest and important to understand exactly how we are doing that. And they are ever busier. As you mentioned, you know, the introduction of offshore wind developments into it and the traffic that also incurs, and making space for nature alongside all of the other uses that we make of our seas. So I think certainly with, as I mentioned, you know, the Devon and Severn Ithaca, their trials of using REM for MPA protections, I think that's a really important one. But using the evidence to understand the really important areas, both for fisheries and for nature, and making sure that we can spatially plan that so that we make it work for both of them, because you know, it's certainly the case that fisheries do still represent that the biggest impact for marine biodiversity, but the way in which it's carried out, where it's carried out, what it's removing and what it's impacting are all key considerations, and REM can help shed a little bit of light on that, and certainly help in the management thereafter. So we do think it's a really important one.
Okay. Thanks.
Anyone else like to come in on that? No, Ariane, would you like to just carry on with your next question?
Thanks. So coming on back to what I was going to ask, but in a way, Elspeth, you've begun to answer it, but I'd like to go into it a little bit further, which is around the use of the data. So the concern that has been raised, again, by stakeholders, that Marine Directorate may not have the capacity to use all of the data. And I would be interested to understand, I hear what you're saying around the need for confidentiality, data protection, that kind of thing. But there are examples globally. So one example is that Peru in 2018 became second country in the world to share all of its VMS tracking data on the Global Fishing Watch platform so that anyone could view it. And there are 12 countries that already have data sharing agreements which allow transparency without breaching commercial confidentiality. So there's various ways we can do that, like lagging the data share by some months and not including individual identifying info. Now, I know if an offshore wind company is trying to get their permission or whatever, a lag of time could be not work in that situation, but it could work in others. So I'd be interested to hear what you think about how we could potentially share the data so that we can actually move much more rapidly in terms of understanding what's going on in our seas and get a much better picture. So maybe Elspeth and then Helen.
Yeah, I don't know the detail of these systems, so I can't comment on them, and I'm not sure what the forms of REM were, but our position is clear that we believe it is very clearly set out what the government's policy intent on this policy is. It's about compliance, it's about deterring non-compliance, and it's providing accountability to ministers. So therefore, from our perspective, that data should remain within government.
Okay. Helen?
So my understanding is, yes, data sharing agreements would need to be set up, and those would be anonymised. And, you know, stepping right back, you know, Elspeth mentioned the policy and management objectives, because that's fundamental to all of this, the way in which you set up your remote electronic monitoring systems. You know, maybe different if you're purely looking at discarding effort within a fleet, or whether you're more interested in looking at sensitive species bycatch. So we've got to be clear about what the policy objectives are. And there is the option for after the event monitoring of data. So, for example, the data is sitting there, but if there was a desire, say for NatureScot, to take some of that data and look at it for a particular species, there would have to be something set up, and it would all be anonymised, and you know, it would have to be agreed off with the industry. But the importance is that the potential is there, and as you've said, there are clear examples that can be used effectively, and it's just about getting those systems right. And it strikes me that the Scottish Government have done a lot of you know, looking elsewhere, taking best practice and trying to be as careful in their bringing it forward as they can, and is my view.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just on the back of that again, we've had times in the past where data has been leaked, which at some point was used to undermine the fishing industry a few years ago, and it certainly put a huge dent in the confidence that the fishing industry had with regards to the Scottish Government and Marine Scotland at that time. Elspeth, are you confident that the SSI, as we will have in front of us, will give you confidence that that data won't be shared in an inappropriate way or in a way that the fishing industry are not comfortable with?
I don't think that the SSI necessarily rules that out. So I think that's a moot point.
So does it need to?
Yes. I think there should be clear legal assurances.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to move on to the next theme. It's financial implications and timescales for implementation. And a question from Eleanor Whittam.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. So I am interested in issues round about financial implications and also round about timescales. And, you know, we have heard in evidence, written evidence back to the committee in this, about fishers being concerned about just the level of investment they're going to have to make to meet their requirements should this come into being. And I guess that's not going to be felt equally across the different parts of the fishing activities and perhaps even, you know, the different size of vessels, etc. And bearing in mind that we do know that this is in place in various places around the world, including, you know, Canada, the US, New Zealand, other parts of the UK, who are also looking to bring it in a wider model as well. I'm wondering how appropriate it is that fishers should pay for the full costs associated with the purchase, the installation, the ongoing maintenance costs of REM equipment. And is it clear what these costs would be? We already see within the BREA that there's a range of different estimates that are contained in there. And is there any examples that anybody on the panel has about the other places in the world where we do know this is in existence? How have those governments and indeed those fishers coped with the cost associated with it? Has there been any incentives or has it been met by industry themselves? So I don't know if we maybe want to start with Elspeth on that and maybe hear from others after.
Yeah, well, I think, as I said earlier, the scallop fleet, I think, was incentivised to adopt the voluntary REM that has been running thus far because they could see that a mandatory approach from government was coming and that if they went down this voluntary route in advance of that, then that would be grant funded. And I think for systems and requirements that are clearly being put in place as a requirement of government, for the purposes of demonstrating compliance, deterring non-compliance and providing accountability to ministers, then I think it is only fair then that the government should meet the cost of installing that equipment that it is requiring businesses to have and that are not going to deliver any tangible or meaningful or as yet clearly articulated benefits to the businesses that are bearing the cost.
Could I come back on that? Do we have any examples maybe across other sectors where, you know, there's high compliance that would be required for instance, animal welfare, where you would perhaps have monitoring equipment within abattoirs, etc., that would be there for compliance issues? So I'm thinking about, you know, is there a comparative example you could give where there would be an incentive or a cost met by government for such activities?
I think abattoirs are quite a good example in some ways in terms of the public pays a very significant proportion of the costs of official controls and of assessing compliance in abattoirs. So I think that there is a parallel there. I think the other aspect that you have to look at here are that the systems that are being proposed are more elaborate than, for example, having simply CCTV in place at a point of slaughter, for example. So I think it's a different model, and I don't know enough about examples from other parts of the world to be able to comment on those. But I think, as I say, the taxpayer pays a significant ongoing cost for ensuring compliance with animal welfare and legislation in abattoirs. So I think there is a parallel.
Okay, if I could come back just also with a question round about the lead-in time. So we know that, you know, it was communicated that there perhaps would be a two-year lead-in, and that's obviously now slightly truncated within what we can see in terms of you know, what's before us. Are there concerns around about that? And I guess also with regards to procuring the equipment itself. We've already heard earlier today that we're not so sure whether the market itself is able to cope with the demand that might be with, you know, on it within the next wee while. So I don't know if anybody's got any comments around about the lead-in times now on this.
I think probably Ian might be able to comment on that.
Yes, certainly it's been a big issue for us, actually, because, as I said, the policy has been a long time in development. We've had a lot of dialogue with Marine Scotland over a number of years, and they've been very, very clear with us in the sense that once the legislation had passed through the parliamentary process and become law, there would be this two-year period. So it was a bit of a shock to us, actually, to see this hard deadline by the middle of March 2026. Appearing, because it was our full understanding that once the Parliament had finished with it, there would be the two full years before implementation. So I would say that's broken a bit of trust between certainly the pelagic fishermen and the Marine Directorate. And it's something I think you should be asking the Cabinet Secretary when she comes before you about why that time frame has changed.
Thanks very much.
I think the time frame has changed because it's part of the Bute House Agreement, which suggests that it should be delivered by the end of the current parliamentary session. Now going to move on to... Thank you.
So, sorry, Convener, but I think that should have been communicated to us if that was the case. And not be led down the garden path that there would be a two-year lead-in period after the legislation was put in place.
Okay, thank you. We're now going to move on to a question on level playing field. Questions from Rachel Hamilton.
Can I direct this to Jo initially, please? Because we know that there are questions around whether this is a level playing field. And from your experience, if you translate that into the situation in Scotland where there are non-Scottish vessels in Scottish waters, however, Marine Scotland will require Scottish vessels to have REM, do you think that that is fair? And how do you relate that to your experience?
Well, it's obviously what's required if the Scottish government says the same thing. And likewise, in the Isle of Man, we make rules and regulations in the Isle of Man waters. Scottish vessels have to come down as long as they're licensed in the Isle of Man, and they have to adhere to. So it only seems fair that we reciprocate that. And if our vessels go and fish in the Scottish waters, then we should align with the Scottish regulations.
Okay. Can I ask Ian Gatt if he can give his comments on whether he believes that this is a level playing field?
Yes, and it's again, it's been one of the issues that we've been in a lot of dialogue, actually, with the Marine Directorate and also the Cabinet Secretary and the previous Cabinet Secretary. And in my office in Fraserburgh, I have got two letters from the Cabinet Secretary saying that they are totally committed to the level playing field. I think what you need to bear in context is that there are around 27 UK pelagic vessels, 23 in Scotland, and I would say there's probably in the region of 150 other external vessels fishing in Scottish waters at various times of the year. So it's been hugely important for us to ensure that the vessels coming into Scotland are adhering to the same regulations that are going to be applied to us. So we were quite pleased that that was seen through to the end. However, I wouldn't say that a full level playing field has been achieved, because what we have to do is ensure our equipment is operational, the REM equipment, when we're in international waters or in third country waters like Norway or fishing off of the west coast of Ireland. And we don't know what the policy is going to be from the other countries, for instance, in Norway or Ireland. When their vessels are fishing in international waters, will they be required to have the REM? That's unknown to us at this stage, but I would have thought it would have been prudent for the Scottish Government to say that they may do this in the future once they get a level playing field with the rest of the countries, but that's not the move they've taken. They've said that we've got to have it on regardless of where we were fishing. The other thing I think, Rachel, it would be slightly concerning to us that there's two types of pelagic vessels operating in Scotland. There's the RSW vessels, like our own fleet, which catches fish, pump it into a tank, come ashore, and the fish is pumped into the factory for processing. The other type, and there's quite a lot of them, there would be, I would imagine, a region of 20 vessels freezing at sea. And, you know, basically you've got the vessel and the factory in one unit. And our concern would be that the factory element of the freezer vessel is adequately covered by the REM so that we are working on a level playing field. And to be honest with you, I'm not sure if that's the case or not. We do see things in the technical specification, but I'm not an expert in it. But that is a concern our fishermen would have in regard to the level playing field.
Just on a sort of a practical point, you know, out at sea, how does the Marine Directive Directorate, how do they ensure that there's compliance on non-Scottish vessels?
Well, I don't know. Maybe Joe's a better place to do that. They're using their assets in terms of looking at data that they've got, VMS data, etc. There's the aeroplanes, and they've obviously got three ships. But it's a big task to, you know, monitor all these vessels at our inner waters, for sure.
Okay, so moving to Elspeth MacDonald on whether you believe this is a fair playing field. I also want to pick up on whether you think that there should be more information on the number of vessels, where they're from, and which have had their REM inspected on an annual basis.
Well, I think you know, the issues are very much as Ian has described. So the requirement will be, for example, in the Scallop fleet, that any vessel fishing in Scottish waters will need to have a system compliant with these requirements. But again, that Scottish vessels fishing out with Scottish waters will still have to have REM fixed, installed and operational when they're fishing elsewhere, whilst other vessels will not. So that doesn't feel like a level playing field, maybe a level playing field within Scottish waters, although we are unclear, I think, about how the government will seek and receive the same assurances from non-Scottish vessels fishing in Scottish waters that they might be seeking from Scottish vessels. So I think there is still an asymmetry here in that when Scottish vessels are fishing elsewhere, they will still be required, again, under the full force of this law, to have their REM installed and operational, whereas other vessels, certainly at the moment, will not. The Scallop fleet generally, a lot of the Scallop fleet will fish in UK waters, but some of the itinerant fleet will also fish in some EU waters. So the playing field certainly will not currently be level when there is an additional legal obligation on the Scottish fleet that is not required for other vessels fishing in the same seas.
To whom does the responsibility lie for sort of international or UK-wide discussions in terms of that level playing field?
Well, with fisheries being a largely devolved issue, it is for the four fisheries administrations in the UK to make their own rules and make their own requirements. Obviously, they have to be compliant with the wider obligations of things like the Fisheries Act and the body of retained law. The four administrations cooperate pretty well, talk quite frequently. I think the fact that Joe is here today with the Isle of Man perspective again shows that sort of collaboration and cooperation and communication. But at the end of the day, the administrations can choose to do different things.
Okay. And Helen, does the Future Fisheries Alliance believe that this SSI has the potential to create an unfair playing field? And what would your sort of suggestion be to achieve a more sort of level playing field as such?
I think it's true to say that we were very pleased to see the application to both UK, to Scottish and non-Scottish vessels fishing across Scottish waters, because that, as Elspeth said, within the Scottish zone gives us that level playing field. As to the requirement for Scottish vessels to use the technology beyond Scottish waters, I think our view was that it could be seen as a leadership thing in terms of the fisheries, the way that fisheries management is going and needs to be going, because there is a broader kind of view that REM is going to have to start become a standard of sustainable fisheries management from an EU perspective, other coastal states. So, you know, we may be a leader in that respect, and certainly when non-Scottish vessels enter our waters and are required to have the technology on them, there may be an acceleration of their application in their own waters as a result of, you know, we have to have the technology if we're going into Scottish waters. Why would we not then consider using that in our own? So we were rather optimistic that it may be a positive thing elsewhere as well as in Scottish waters.
And just to pick up on what Ian Gatt said around there being 150 non-UK vessels fishing the pelagic waters, do you think that it's possible, and does Marine Scotland have the resource to be able to analyse all the data collected from that RAM, and is it possible to share that data? Because you wouldn't want to be, you know, you want to be unbiased when it comes to gathering data, because you wouldn't want to be targeting Scottish vessels only, because they would need to use a sort of a suitable sampling programme, so where they were randomising that data rather than actually picking on certain vessels. So how do you think that will work?
So I think, and obviously you'll be able to hear this firsthand from your session next week, but my understanding would be those vessels, as they enter Scottish waters, so they'll have to have it in place as a condition of fishing in our waters. So the technology will be there, and Scottish administrations will be able to pick up the data or access the data. In terms of the resources, looking across the board, when we first did sort of calculation of the cost benefits of REM as opposed to traditional methods, it indicated very much that quite a lot of traditional at-sea monitoring could probably be substituted for a greater resource investment in REM. So, you know, for a quarter of the cost of traditional, you could be looking at 100% access to data. Now, that's not 100% review, because you're not sitting there reviewing all of the data, but you are able to review those key moments of the, when hauls are coming in, for example. So there's definitely something to be looked at in terms of the cost of REM application and review, as opposed to traditional methods, which incorporate some of the things that Ian was talking about in terms of vessels, aeroplanes, quayside inspections. Some of those could be done away with because you've actually got evidence that's coming in the whole time. So I think there's definitely ways that the resource can be delivered and the benefits with it.
Just on that, convener, I think that Marine Scotland are going to need a huge pool
of human analyzers to actually look at the screens and the data. And, you know, I've heard that, you know, humans can make mistakes. I've not heard that. We know that we can make mistakes, but there is only a certain time that humans can actually look at a screen. And so you're going to need a huge pool of resource to be able to analyse that data to make it, I suppose, meaningful.
I think, yeah, looking at so some of the reallocation of resources from quayside inspections, training people up for monitoring data, the data review process has come on in leaps and bounds, and I think, you know, one operator can be looking at 25, 30 screens quite effectively, the way that they're set up. And if you think about, so for the Scallop fleet and other fleets, it's maybe different, but for the Pelagics, you've obviously got quite a set window, so you could, you know, you could bank yourself up, as it were, for that particular season. But I think the way in which the review is now being undertaken has come on massively, and so it may not be as many as you may think to be able to effectively review the key bits of data which are that we need to look at for purposes of both compliance and wider impacts.
Okay, just finally, final, to Joe. How many non-compliance situations have you come across with vessels that are not registered to your fisheries?
We have it depends on what time frame you're going back. So we average, it's not a big fishing fleet. I think we've got 120 odd licenses, and we average possibly 2-3 successful prosecutions a year. And that can be all manner of things, from going into closed areas to incorrect gear, fishing outside curfew, undersized scallops. Mainly it's the scallop fish we were talking about. So it's not a huge amount. But they're obviously detected by the systems we've got, the satellite systems we've got, the tracking systems, and obviously the fishing protection vessel, putting people on the boats themselves. That's the biggest way we find our issues, is to actually put our fisheries officers on board the boats to do the inspections at sea.
Just on the relationship between the Isle of Man fishery and Scottish fishery, there is a long tradition of Scottish boats fishing in Manx waters and vice versa. That relationship hasn't always been harmonious, and I know we had a uncomfortable situation 4 or 5 years ago when Scottish boats had to land the scallops in Douglas, which caused some tensions. Can you update us on what the current situation is between working between the Scottish Government or the Marine Directorate and yourself as the Isle of Man Fisheries?
Yeah, we work very well together. Like the case I alluded to before with the Oban office, obviously we'd legal lawful data protection requests to obtain the data, but we do work together very well, and obviously not necessarily myself, but I know the policy manager's been working keen with the Scottish Government on developing policy for the RAM, and we're wholly supportive of it, and we're glad you're taking the lead, and we're not far behind you, obviously, because we need a number of our vessels to have it anyway for June. So,
thank you. And just the last question for me before I move on to Rhoda. You know, the Scottish boats fish in Isle of Man waters, and they fish in French waters. What happens if the Isle of Man decides to diverge from the technology that the Scottish Government are specifying, and Europe have a different specification for REM? Can you see the situation where scallop boats in Scotland have three lots or four lots or multiple lots of technology to deliver data for different reasons to different fisheries control authorities?
I suppose the analogy will be similar to the e-log that they have to use, that they've had on board their vessels for a number of times, where there's four or five different suppliers. So I think it's down to the actual specifications to make sure it meets all the requirements. I can't really answer any more than that, I'm afraid.
OK, thank you. Rhoda and then Emma.
Thank you, Convener. Just a question for Helen, and a wee bit maybe from left field, but as you were talking about and with Rachel about the effort taken to look at all this data coming from cameras, has anyone used AI to look at that, to pick up different species and kind of, I suppose, process that information a lot faster?
Yes, absolutely. And artificial intelligence, again, is growing in capabilities day by day and is reliant on a lot of information being put in there. So we know, for example, now that certainly marine mammals will be very quickly identified by AI. We think seabirds are probably possible, and there's also technology at the minute looking at how you actually identify different fish species so that you could automatically preferentially open the net gate or the gate of the end of the net to let those ones that you don't have any quota for out and only catch the ones that you do have quota for. So AI has a tremendous role to play and will continue to contribute into this, and I think we'll see it developing by leaps and bounds as it has to date in all other many other areas.
Thank you
Emma.
So that was actually very similar to what I was asking, because the data that's being collected will be driven by algorithms, designs and artificial intelligence as that moves forward. So I'm assuming it's not just about human beings sitting looking at TV cameras. And just looking at this document here says that putting cameras on boats that are longer than 10 metres in the UK, which catch over 90% of the fish, would cost between 4.8 and 6.75 million a year. And that's less than 1% of the value of seafood caught by the vessels. So basically putting cameras on the vessels is a way to help manage some of that cost of capturing the data and then interrogating the data, whether it's used by artificial intelligence or by humans. Is that a reasonable thing to say?
Yeah, absolutely. And as I say, a lot of AI will start to take over more and more of that review process as it becomes more and more capable. And the management will feed into, at the minute we've got, less than half of the fishing limits of UK interests are set in line with ICES advice. So that's an indication that we're not doing well in terms of, achieving our sort of sustainability objectives within fisheries. This sort of information could help improve that. Okay, thanks.
Elspeth?
I think we need to recognise that AI won't happen on its own, and I come back to my point about the need for government to invest in such a in this sort of technology if these benefits could ever be realised, and the concerns that we have expressed here and in other fora around the government's capability and capacity to actually do that. So I reiterate my point about a lot of this sounding rather like sort of jam tomorrow than something that can meaningfully be delivered. And just on the point that Helen made about setting tax in line with ICES advice, I think it's important to remember that sustainability has three pillars to it. It's not just about biological sustainability, it's also about social and economics sustainability. And it is incumbent on managers in our fisheries administrations to take all of these factors into account in setting tax.
Thank you. And finally, a yes-no response from, I don't think I can ask Joe this, but given the lead-in times for introducing REM have been accelerated because of the Beautice Agreement, which could potentially leave fishing boats unable to find people to repair the equipment as quick as they might, which means boats can't go to sea, should the Scottish Government compensate fishers in that event? Elspeth?
Yes.
Ian?
Yeah, absolutely. As I said already, that our seasons are very, very short, and you know, I think it would be a tragedy if an outcome was that a vessel was tied up, lost his entire fishing season because of the malfunctioning of the equipment.
Helen?
I think between now and June 26, for 22 vessels to be kitted out is probably adequate time, having spoken to a number of experts on this.
Okay. That brings us to an end. Thank you very much. We're back. We've obviously run over time quite some bit, but I think the additional time allowed us to just explore some of these issues a little bit more. So thank you very much for your time this morning. That concludes our business in public. We'll now move into private session.